3 million and counting. And of those, Black women have the highest average of eviction filed against them at 6.2%, compared to white women at 3.4%. Now that equates to 1 in 4 Black renters living in a place where Black eviction filing rates.
Yesterday, I got an email from a good brother of mine's here on YouTube, and I don't even want to disclose his name because how controversial this topic is. Unfortunately, it's a video that is from CBS News, and the name of the video was called Black Women Have the Highest Eviction Rates in the United States. Now, again, we've heard so many times about how educated Black women are, how they're doing really, really well, they're gaining in all the sectors, healthcare, entrepreneurship, fashion, you name it. Unfortunately, Black women though are being evicted higher than any other group in the country. Let's look at this video that's going to talk about it, and let's react to it.
Housing security in the U.S. since the pandemic is on track to become a crisis, and Black women are being affected the most by it. According to Eviction Lab, there were more than 434,000 evictions last year. So for some context to this, the eviction moratorium was in place for a large portion of the year, but the number of renters at risk of eviction as of January spiked to about 3 million and counting. Mm-hmm. And of those, Black women have the highest average of eviction filed against them at 6.2%, compared to white women at 3.4%. Now that equates to 1 in 4 Black renters living in a place where Black eviction filing rates were almost double than that of their white counterparts.
All right, let's kind of look at that again. Black women is at 6.2%. Latinx women, or Latin women, at 3.8%, white women at 3.4%. Why is that? In my honest opinion, it has a lot to do with Black women being a lot less single than the other groups. And also, and what they're qualified for educationally, it's not representative in what they're doing in the workforce. Again, right? A person can say they're highly educated, but now, many people tend to not do what they went to school for, right? Most people don't. So that has to be two of the main reasons, right? No man in the house, not earning a lot of money, and not being married. But let's continue.
So joining us now is Akira Drake Rodriguez. She's an assistant professor of city and regional planning at the Stuart Weisman School of Design at the University of Pennsylvania. Mm-hmm. She's also the author of Diverging Space for Deviants, The Politics of Atlanta's Public Housing. Mm-hmm. Professor Drake, great to have you with us. Thank you for joining us. So can you give us an idea of why evictions are so high for Black women specifically and the short and long-term impact it's having on them and their families?
Sure. So Black women traditionally are tasked with a lot of the caretaking roles of both their immediate family, but also their extended family. And so what you're more likely to see is that these are the women who are going to be having to take in cousins, having to take in people who are experiencing their own economic precarity or housing precarity, mm-hmm. In addition to their own families. As sort of the head caretakers, you also see that they're more likely to make these sorts of sacrifices. So you see Black women, and all women actually, but Black women in particular, because they have kind of less opportunity and less access, more likely to stay, for example, in substandard housing.
Less access. Maybe we won't talk about less access, because how are they the highest? We hear it all the time. Black women are the largest or highly educated group, most highest educated group in America. So how is that less access? They're accessible to education, right? They should be accessible in the workforce in comparison to Black men who have less education. So why is it that Black women are taking on these additional family members into their own family? this doesn't make a whole lot of sense. It's kind of moving the goalpost, right? But let's kind of listen more.
Housing, if it means that their child has access to a good school or they have access to a job opportunity. And so you kind of create these sort of cascading problems and issues when it comes to evictions, and that they are more likely to lose their job. They are more likely to have to travel further for work, increasing their economic precarity, and more likely to be the caretaker and taking on a lot of additional families into their household. So getting this eviction is this very sort of permanent stain on their record. It impacts their credit, it impacts their ability to find more housing. A lot of these Black women are more likely to experience bouts of homelessness as a result of these evictions. Their credit is less likely to remain intact after having some of these housing issues. Mm-hmm. So it's really, when we talk about intersectionality, it really is a prime example of how intersectionality works, right? They are less likely to be employed. They are making lower wages. They are in substandard housing units. And these impacts are huge. As you can see, the psychological trauma, the difficulty, and, you know, imagine getting turned down for housing opportunity after housing opportunity.
Seems like, let me say this, Black women are adults, okay? And what we're acting like is that, you know, everything is against them. Black women, like anybody else, just like Black men, are making what? Decisions. Are they making decisions that are positively impacting them? Sure, we brag about it all the time when Black women are the most educated group. Then we can then say, Black women are making good decisions in the college, university, educational affairs, things of that nature, right? But now when Black women are having issues, it's everybody else's fault. It's everybody else's fault that they can't get a job, they're living in substandard housing, they have to take in additional family members. But now when they're successful, in spite of all of that, they're the number one educated group in America. But now, when they are not performing very well, they get to shift that responsibility to other groups. Like, as if they didn't have decisions that they make themselves that could put them in certain situations. If they're the first to lose their job, why? Okay? Because they're the most highly educated group. Now, if they're making lower wages, why? What are they going to school for? What are they studying in school? Are they matching up the economy for what they're going to be doing in school? Does those two things correlate? Because if you're going to school for like journalism or sociology, maybe that doesn't pay a lot of money if you're living in New York City or Philadelphia or certain bigger areas or Atlanta. Maybe they're not ready for the economy, for the market that's going to be happening. Or maybe they're getting in relationships with the wrong person or dealing with the wrong individuals. I'm hearing a lot of things, but as if Black women are not, you know, they basically are not making any decisions on their own that can impact them. That's what I'm hearing.
Opportunity, economic opportunity, it can really, really start to have an impact on their mental health as well.
Sure, and their families as well, because I imagine they are also more likely to have children in tow, correct?
For sure. Yes, this is a very difficult problem.
So, Professor, according to that report by Eviction Lab,
more likely to have children, right? So we're getting away from that. So if they're having children and they're unmarried, why is that? Will the professor talk about that? Why is that? If they're more likely to have children, and some women in the Black community, have more than one kid by more than one different father who they're not involved with in the life. Maybe they don't even want to be involved in the life. Why is that the case? Again, we're not asking the decisions of said women as to why the predicament is what it is.
We talked about earlier, women in general are evicted more than men. So how do you think the Department of Housing and Urban Development could be, you know, addressing this issue, especially for Black women, but for women in general?
I think it's really important to know about these causes of higher rates of eviction and really thinking about the full package that is required to house someone. It is not just the provision of a voucher. It's not just the provision of a subsidy. It is not just the provision of a single unit. It really is this sort of bundle of care, of transportation, of mental health supports, of physical health supports, the ability to have flexible housing. So often you are allotted housing based on the number of dependents you have, and people can wait on very long waiting lists, and suddenly the housing they're allotted is pretty much obsolete to their needs. So having responsive, flexible housing, having the wraparound services, which HUD does, they do a lot of social service wraparound support, but it needs to be so much more, particularly as the department does much more.
No. That's not what's needed. What you're saying is we need to have more affordable housing to help these people who may be making bad decisions in America, whatever the race may be, men or women. Let's throw more money at bad decisions when really what we need to do, housing, and people need to tell people is, listen, do not have kids, okay, before you're married and financially able to do so. Some people are living above their means, period. Mismanagement of funds, period. We don't talk about that. A lot of people get evicted because they don't manage their money right, men or women. We're not talking about that. A lot of people are not investing in their own development. They take their money and go to the club and buy drinks, but you're not investing in what may improve your job skill in your current industry that might get you someplace in the future. Maybe you're not a responsible roommate and you don't pay your rent. All of these are other factors that we're not looking at. Some of these people are just not responsible. Okay? That's what it is.
More with vouchers and mobility solutions that place people out of their kinship networks and place people out of where they have their home base and their sort of support network. Those are the things that really make housing a home. And I think the more that HUD sort of understands that full bundle of what is needed to house someone properly, that will help with the solutions.
And Professor, what advice do you have for anyone who may be watching right now and facing eviction and not sure what to do? What resources could you point them to?
Definitely look into your local tenant association, look into your local fair housing center so they can provide you with the legal advice that is needed and connect you with the services and support that is available. There has been usually, if you kind of look into the eviction subsidies.
I don't want to hear that crap anymore, okay? Here's what people need to do as an adult. Be responsible, all right? You're an adult. If you're not ready to have kids, then don't have them. If your family is not doing very well, don't have them come live with you, okay? If you have a job, don't get fired. Actually be a good employee. If you're losing your job based on performance, and yes, some people are bad employees, don't say I got fired because I was a woman. Maybe you got fired because you're not a good employee. Do you stay late? Do you look for opportunities? Are you focused while you're at your job? Do you actually do good work? Are you intentional about your career goals? Are you intentional about your financial decisions? All of these things, being financially literate and understanding where you can live, where you can work, what you can and cannot afford, it keeps you, okay, housed in the economy. Being intentional about your success. Nobody's going to baby people because you're an adult, right? If you're a man or you're a woman, nobody's going to hold your hand. And if you really want to be a part of something a little bit more safety, be a part of communities. There are people who do business. There are people who, have other opportunities, side gigs. If you're going to date to marry. Marry a nice guy. There are many nice guys out there who want to get married. Okay? Be intentional about what you want to do. It helps a lot in life. But to kind of make all these excuses as to why Black women are not housed, But then at the same time, we're talking about how successful Black women are. How can you be the most educated group at the same time you're the most evicted? Because something isn't adding up. You're studying the wrong thing that's not conducive to the current economy, okay? Possibly not managing your money right, student loans, things like that, being unmarried, and then you can couple that with maybe making some bad dating decisions or decisions that are bad for your family. It all means it's terrible, right? Lack, and then there's no male leadership there. Women are suffering in the Western world, not having any sort of leadership from, I'm gonna say it, be honest, from a man, from a husband. Women who are not being evicted have good husbands. They're out there. Women are not made, in my honest opinion, all of them be making it by themselves. You need men to come in to help women, to build communities, to make it safe for them, and then let women come in and administrate them. Women and children need certain protections. So that's the way God made it. Don't get mad at me. And when you try to remove a woman from a man, women suffer more, especially in the Black community. But guys, I'm out. Another episode of Fair Use. Peace.